Hello everybody, welcome to IDAGIO Live. This time we have the fourth symphony by Gustav Mahler. I want to help you through the symphony, how to listen to it. Well, it's very difficult to say how does one listen to a symphony, but maybe it helps if you consider a few things about this work. I would suggest to focus on two aspects. One, that this is a neoclassical symphony. Neoclassical means that Mahler usually composed for a huge orchestra, very big, long symphonies, and this, compared to the others, is relatively short, smaller orchestra. One could almost say a chamber orchestra, no trombones, not too many instruments generally, and a very delicate style. And the whole style of the music is somehow related to Haydn, Mozart, to the Rococo, to the late 18th century. There are other composers who compose neoclassical symphonies. Stravinsky had such a period, and there is the first symphony by Prokofiev, for example. It's even called classical symphony. The other idea I want to put in your mind before listening to this great work is that this is a childish symphony. Now let's consider, what does childish mean? First of all, we usually say it to grown-ups, that you are childish, or somebody behaves in a childish way. And what do we mean? What is the difference? Children have emotions, strong feelings, which maybe they control a little less. They have less kind of barriers, which they don't want to cross certain barriers, or they limit, they don't want to show these very extreme feelings what children show. If a child is sad, then the child cries. If a child is happy, then there is this fantastic shining eyes and the laughter. It comes out in a more immediate way than with us grown-ups. But actually, we are the same people. We have the same feelings. So deep down, everybody has an inner child. And certain people, and especially great musicians, keep this inner child awake. And they behave a little in a childish way because they don't want to limit and suppress those feelings. And Mahler was certainly a person for whom the childish feelings were extremely important, fascinating. This symphony, the fourth symphony, ends with a simple childish song of a child's vision of paradise. There are animals running around, and there are various saints who are like an aunt or an uncle. And everything is happy, and it feels like a playground. But the other movements also have something childish in this symphony. And together with the neoclassical style and this attitude, there is a fantastic fairy tale which Mahler tells us, very different to all of his other symphonies. Now, how does he start? He simply does something very strange, almost crazy, like. Two flutes play this, but the special thing is the percussionist, who under this plays as a group of sleigh bells. So immediately we are in a fairy tale situation. And then the story starts, and here comes the neoclassical aspect. He starts with an extremely Viennese, cozy, nice little melody. But this D sharp is so beautiful. So it's. Rhythm carries us into the symphony. And this is the start of the first movement. Outrageously childish elements pop up. The clarinet, they have to hold up their instruments and they play. I mean, it's kindergarten, isn't it? And this is the world we are introduced into. So that will be the first movement, very happy, lively, full of jokes and full of childish, lovely impressions. Second movement. If you listen in a concert, you see that the concertmaster has two violins. One is tuned extremely sharp. It should sound ugly, a little scary, like a devil's violin. And then this first violinist plays this melody, tries to seduce us. It's really scary. If I imagine I would be a 5 or 6 year old and somebody would come to me with this devilish face playing this tuned up violin. It's really fearful. Now, what does this violin play? Actually, it's very nice melody. Is this probably it has an origin of. It's just very nicely ornamented. Because the first note, instead of the basic note, which is the C, which we would need to feel the security, he actually starts a semitone lower, and that gives it a devilish, scary something. This. Listen. Something in Mahler, which I also consider childish, the childish fear of something really scary. Well, after you had a big scare in the second movement, you can listen to one of the most beautiful slow movements Mahler composed, and these slow movements somehow became the most popular of his music. You remember last week in the third symphony we had this beautiful this melody. Now this is I would say a similar world. Of course it's different in different key, different feeling, but listen to this of. There is this heartbeat and this beautiful, the strings play, the cellos lead the melody. It's one of those long, loving melodies which I consider a kind of divine love in Mahler's music. Nothing erotic, nothing sensuous, only pure flowing love, which is a very long movement, extremely beautiful, takes us to all kinds of emotional, a variety of feelings. but actually it ends in a beautiful harmony. There's a big climax, and the Mahler wrote in the score that the heaven opens up, and now the heaven is open, and we see this little child, which is represented usually by a female singer, but we have to imagine a childish little angel who says, "Ha ha, nice animals, saints, everything, beautiful paradise." So this is the last psalm. And then at the end, this angel says that music is more beautiful than one can imagine, and it fills us in this beautiful paradise. So music becomes an extremely important element in this vision, in this childish vision of paradise. There's something so free about it. I love, there's a recording where Mahler plays a piano roll, and he plays it very freely, this angel in paradise. And this is this childish vision, the end of this neoclassical childish fourth symphony by Gustav Mahler. I hope you will like it. Let's see if you have questions which I can answer. I always get it on my phone. Now, so here we go. I don't really see anybody has answered. Maybe you can still send me questions. I would love to answer them. It's actually very nice to know what is in your mind. Let's see if we get something. One second. Somebody is writing. I don't know, maybe I will wait. Meanwhile, I want to tell you that Mahler struggled, of course, because his imagination was so different than reality. What kind of singer should sing the final song? And then he ended up writing it for a soprano voice, but he wrote above it that it should be a childlike voice. Then he got scared of it, that somebody will imitate a child and it will be disgusting. And then he wrote there, "But please, not a parody." So it should be a childlike voice, but not a parody. Well, great task for singers. Now, I've got one question here, which says, "Can you tell us about other neoclassical composers?" I did at the beginning, especially the 20th century was playing a lot with this idea of neoclassical. Everybody who I can think of played with this idea, even for example Benjamin Britten has something called simple symphony. But this idea of Prokofiev is probably the best, which I can compare this image of a neoclassical symphony, that instead of using the fashionable, great, grand, huge orchestra of the time of Richard Strauss or Gustav Mahler, Prokofiev decided to compose for a chamber orchestra in a sparkling, happy and somehow, yes, problemless, easy style, which has a certain brilliance. And this ease and brilliance is also the territory of this fourth symphony of Gustav Mahler. I think usually it's played with a little too heavy orchestra. I can imagine it with a small string size and a few winds, no trombones, of course, and an extremely happy, light chamber music-like playing would probably fit this work, unlike all the other symphonies of Mahler. When next week we will get to the fifth, it will be huge again. 6, 7, not to speak of 8 and 9, of course. So actually Mahler made an excursion here into the 18th century once in his life. Thank you very much for listening. This was IDAGIO Live. Now you can click down there, you will see links of my recording of the Fourth Symphony and another link with other recordings of the Budapest Festival Orchestra with me. I will see you next week. We will talk about Mahler's Fifth Symphony. Goodbye.